Hello again. In this lesson, I'm going to talk about maps, or the other half of maps from what I talked about before. As you may recall, I mentioned that there are two components of modeling applied to problem solving. The one that was discussed before, and the one that's more relevant to you when you start a problem, is the modeling process. The idea that you can, that you should and can approach problems in a systematic way using the system interaction model approach, and that by figuring out the systems and the interactions, you will then be led towards the correct model. Now, what is the model that you're going to be led to? It's a core model. It's one of the basic core physical principles of Newtonian mechanics, something that you probably are already familiar with, such as momentum or energy or angular dynamics or angular momentum, but it's a model that's based on the equations that you probably already know, but it's a model that's based on the concepts, on these core concepts. And so we have to discuss in detail what constitutes a core model. In addition to using models to represent the core physical ideas, we also arrange them in a hierarchy. And I'll be discussing that hierarchy a little bit later. But it's designed basically to highlight the similarities and the differences in these models so that you can easily categorize a problem as being accessible by a certain model. Now I want to discuss how the core models and the hierarchy of core models on one hand are related to the modeling process on the other, and how you go about thinking about the distinctions between these two things and how you transfer information from the core models to the modeling process to the problem you have at the beginning. Well, let me just start to remind you that in the modeling process, you are basically solving specific problems. And in addition, you're constructing the knowledge, you're constructing the solution. How do you put together existing pieces to make a new thing, which is the solution to that problem? Now, you start by approaching each problem using the system interaction model method. You think carefully about what the systems and what the interactions are. And the modeling process is basically one in which you're applying the syllabus content or the core conceptual content of physics, and that is arranged in terms of models. And the idea is that the models represent the theory. At least from the point of view of somebody taking this course, you're not the person who derived some of these models. You did not invent the idea of energy and show how it followed from F equals ma. Really, from your point of view as a problem solver, energy and momentum are different concepts from F equals ma. So these things involve theory and they involve existing knowledge. You didn't invent that knowledge. The structure of all these core models is the same. They all have an allowed system. There is a point particle, for example, or a number of point particles, or a rigid body, a wheel, for example. These are different types of systems. All these models have relevant interactions or important forces. These are the things that are the causative agent for the change in that particular model. And finally, all of these different physical models, core physical models, have an equation of change, which is basically a core physical model. And that equation of change is always of the form some aspect related to the forces is acting on the system, and it's changing the properties of that system, the velocity, for example, and it's changing that through a first-order differential equation that will be something like For example, in Newton's model of dynamics of a point particle in F equals mdv dt, the equation has the sum of all the forces, that's the net force on the left, and it has mdv dt, the rate of change of the velocity, on the right. And it tells you that the velocity is changed by the force agent, which is the net force. If you were talking about rotational model, a rotational model, then the force would be manifest as torques. The torques would be the agent of change. So now I'm going to introduce the key idea of mechanics and the hierarchy that we have developed to do this. And I'm going to show you explicitly how Newton's laws, or Newton's second law, is a core model. And I want to stress again that all models are what are sometimes called process models or models of change. They tell you how some aspect of the force changes the motion. So basically, you start off in mechanics with the motion. And since we're talking about Newton's second law, really the motion we're concerned about is translation motion, the motion of moving through space. And we're dealing with a point particle, so the fact that it rotates, you couldn't detect that it rotates. So we're just dealing with position. Now, position can be changed by interactions, and the interactions are manifest as forces. In fact, they're manifest as external forces. The forces acting on the particle are what change it. Now we have filled in the top part of our modeling hierarchy. Let's look at how the component pieces of the model are arranged. There is the interactions, which we've just discussed, and then important is the type of system and what are the forces, the relevant forces that cause change, and what is the exact model by which those forces change the variable that describes the system. And so let's look at that for Newton's laws. So essentially, for Newton's laws, we have next a system here that the system is a single point particle, and we have the name of the model, which is called dynamics or linear dynamics, and net force. All the models have some name of the what's changing, and they indicate what aspect of force changes that. Now then, the way that the forces do that is that the external forces are used to define the sum of all the forces, and that is the agent of change for the velocity. And this is again represented by Newton's equation, the sum of all the forces, or the net force, equals the mass times the rate of change of the velocity. Now, when we have that situation, that we know what the agent of change is, a very important subclass of physical problems arises when that agent of change is zero. So you always ask, now I see that equation, what if the net force is zero? Well, some quantity will be constant in every model. Some quantity will become constant when the agent of change is zero. And you already know from Newton's first law what that is in the case of linear dynamics. If there is no net force, the particle continues moving in a straight line with constant speed. In other words, the velocity does not change.